great white open. Resurrection power, the curse is broken.
Good morning. Why don't you stand to your feet with us? Who knows what day it is? He is risen. Yeah, come on, say he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Come on, put your hands together just like this. Hey, hey. Come on, let's hear. Say everything.
Everything.
That has breath.
That has breath.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Still in control.
Oh, yes, you are, God. Let's praise. let's sing about his goodness. Let's sing. I praise cause you're sovereign. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. Amen. I praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Sing it again. I praise cause you're sovereign. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Sing that out.
Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Sometimes you gotta tell yourself,
praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Gathered with us this morning at our church building and on our live stream. Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 118. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of the righteous, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, and the righteous shall enter through it. I thank God that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us pray. Sovereign Lord, you have established your rule over the human heart, not by force, but by the servant example of Jesus Christ. Move us by your Spirit to join the joyful procession of those who confess Christ Jesus with their tongues.
God, we're grateful for your sacrifice. We're even greater, great, more grateful for your victory this morning. Amen. Come on, let's sing. I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade were never enough. And put me back together. celebrate your victory this morning, Jesus. King of kings and Lord of lords. And what a subversive king you are. Not riding on a white horse, but riding humbly on a donkey. Not a conquering king coming and commanding everyone. Seated. Thanks for worshiping with us this morning.
Good morning, Oasis family. Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 10. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. From the Gospel of John, chapter 20. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. "Tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabuni." Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The kids have joined us for community worship this morning, and we're so glad to have them with us. But now it's time for them to go with Pastor Kristen to Oasis Kids in the duplex.
In the grand narrative of history, there are moments that defy expectation, refashioning the very fabric of our understanding. 2,000 years ago, in a humble corner of the world, a man walked among us. His teachings sparked hope, his miracles stirred wonder, but it was his final act that would change everything. Betrayed, crucified, and entombed, his story seemed to reach its tragic conclusion. But what appeared to be the end was merely an unexpected turn in the greatest story ever told. For on the third day, the stone was rolled away and death itself was conquered. Jesus, the Son of God, rose from the dead, turning despair into hope, darkness into light. The resurrection of Jesus Christ isn't just a turn in the story. It's the climax of redemption, the triumph of love over hate, and the promise of eternal life for all who believe. Join us as we explore the timeless significance of this plot twist in the story of Jesus, the ultimate narrative of grace, forgiveness, and transformation.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah is exactly right. You know, it's real popular these days to listen to podcasts. I'm all the time, somebody's like, have you heard this podcast? Have you heard that podcast? And I'm always like, no. Like, when do people listen to podcasts all the time? I can't tell you how many have been recommended to me, and maybe some of you have recommended to me that I should listen to a podcast. And I'm just going to go ahead now and confess it publicly. If you have recommended that I should listen to a podcast, chances are I haven't. The only person who apparently who can make me listen to a podcast is Angela. Because she will listen to some, and every once in a while she'll say, hey, listen to this. But the hey, listen to this, like she's like, we're both in bed, and she's like playing it on the Amazon Echo. So I'm going to listen. So I guess here's the trick. If you want me to listen to a podcast, convince Angela that it is good and worthy to listen to, and then she'll play it for me, and I'll be in bed. Like, where else am I going to go? So it wasn't that long ago. It was actually quite recently that she played this episode from This American Life. It was actually from 2001, and it was titled Kids Logic, about how children think. And it started with a prologue that told two stories, and the first one was about 2 7-year-old girls, Rachel and Rebecca, best friends. So Rebecca gets to school, and Rachel's like, Rebecca, come here, I've got something to tell you. I know who the tooth fairy is. And she's like, well, how do you know? Well, she said, well, last night I put a tooth under my pillow, and then in the middle of the night I woke up, and my dad was taking the tooth out and putting some money in. My dad is the tooth fairy. So Rebecca goes home that day just full of herself, right? She knows something now that most people don't know. And so Rebecca announced to her mom, I know who the tooth fairy is. And so her mom's like, well, who's the tooth fairy? And she said, it's Ronnie Loberfeld. Ronnie Loberfeld, of course, is Rachel's father. She's like, well, what makes you think that Ronnie Loberfeld... No, excuse me. She said, oh, listen, that's a secret. You can't tell anybody. And so for years, right, she went on believing that Ronnie Loberfeld was the tooth fairy. In fact, her mom, when she put money under her pillow, would sign it, Love Ronnie. So the question is, why did both girls come to such a conclusion? Allison Gopnik, who studies how children think, says, of course it's logical for a 7-year-old to conclude that her father might be the tooth fairy. Because from the perspective of a child, their parents seem as though they can do anything. I remember this. Like, I remember being young and my parents driving us around, and for the life of me, I could not figure out how they knew where to turn. Like, how do you ever get anywhere? Like, I'll never be able to drive because I never know what road to turn on. My children, of course, don't have that because they know exactly where to turn because the GPS is saying, in 500 feet, take a right, right? It's a different world. But therapist Eileen Goldman in Texas tells another story. This is the last short one, about a little girl on an airplane. Eileen says this, that the girl's about 4 years old, and she was on her very first flight, and as the plane was airborne, she turned to the woman next to her and said, when do we get smaller? Of course, she had seen planes take off, and every time you see a plane take off, it gets smaller. And I guess she just thought that at some point they would all just get smaller. So Ira Glass says that these stories are like jokes, and they're like also like poems, and that he thinks that there's an aha quality to them. Some kind of connection is made between things, a surprising connection, a wrong connection, actually. And part of what makes these so satisfying as stories is that the logic in them is perfectly reasonable and at the same time completely and utterly wrong. Glass goes on to say this, while kids think with the same logic that adults use and apply that logic just as rigorously, there are certain things that they simply do not know and they take a while to figure out. Up to age 6 or 7, for instance, it is not exactly clear to anyone what is imaginary and what is not, or if wishing for something can make something come true. So scientists tried to study this. So they got two groups of children, and they with the two different groups, they each had a box. And they said, hey, with one group of children, they said, hey, let's imagine that in this box is a puppy. Let's just imagine, let's use our imaginations, that the box has a puppy in it. And with the other group of children, they said, hey, let's imagine that this box has a monster in it. Well, the kids who were imagining that there was a puppy in it, as they went to walk by the box, they got really close to it, and some even peeked in it. And the kids that were imagining there was a monster in it stayed pretty far away from it, right? Because they were being kind of shaped by that. Which leads me to the heart of this podcast that I wanted to share with you. A man named Jack Hitt shared this story. He said it all began at Christmas a few years ago, which would have been in the late 90s now, when his daughter was 4 years old. It was the first time she had ever asked what was the reason for that holiday. And so he explained to her that they were celebrating the birth of Jesus, and she wanted to know more about that. And when he brought, he then bought her a kid's Bible and had these readings every night with her, and she loved them. She wanted to know everything there was to know about Jesus. So they read a lot about his birth and about his teaching, and she would ask constantly what that phrase was. The phrase was the one that he would have to explain to her, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And he would talk about these old words and what they all meant. And then one day, they were driving past a big church in town, and out in front was an enormous crucifix. And she said, who is that? And he had to guess, well, he had never told her that part of the story. So he kind of laughed and he said, well, that's Jesus. And I forgot to tell you the ending. You see, he ran afoul of the Roman government. This message that he had was so radical and unnerving that to the prevailing authorities at the time, they thought they just had to kill him. They came to the conclusion that he would have to die, that his message was too troublesome. About a month later, after Christmas, and they had gone through the whole story of what Christmas meant, it was mid-January, and her preschool, which celebrated the same holidays as the local schools, was off for Martin Luther King Day. And so Jack took the day off, and he decided that he would just play and with his daughter and take her to lunch. So while they were sitting there, right at the table where they happened to plop down, there was a section of the local newspaper, and as big as life, there was a huge drawing by a 10-year-old kid from some local school of Martin Luther King. And so she said, who's that? And he said, well, as it happens, that's Martin Luther King. And he's why we're not in school today. So we're celebrating his birthday. And this is the day that we celebrate his life. And she said, well, who is he? And I said, well, he was a preacher. And she looked at me and goes, for Jesus? And I said, yeah, actually, he was. But there was another thing that he was really famous for, which is that he had a message. And you're trying to say this now to a 4-year-old, remember? This is the first time they've ever heard anything. So you're just very careful about how you want to phrase. So what he said was, he was a preacher who had a message. And she said, what was his message? And I said, well, he said that you should treat everybody the same, no matter what they look like. And she thought about it for a minute. And she said, well, that's what Jesus said. And he's like, well, yeah, I guess I've never thought about it before. But that does sound a lot like do unto others as you would have them do unto you. So she thought for a minute. And she looked up at me and she said, did they kill him too? I want to tell a couple of stories today. One comes, it's not actually a passage that we read. It comes from the Gospel of Luke. And Jesus has returned to Nazareth. It's his kind of first Sabbath back now as an established rabbi in Capernaum. And he comes that day. And as he's there, I guess he's the guest speaker. And so the attendant hands to him the scroll of Isaiah, which is a different practice maybe than what we would have. Like we all might bring our Bibles to church or have them on our phones or tablets or what have you. But in ancient times, they wouldn't even have all of the text in one document, right? They had a Torah scroll and a Psalm scroll and Isaiah scroll. And they had an attendant who took care of those things. And then they had certain, just the same way we follow a lectionary, the Jews in the synagogue had certain readings that they would keep throughout the year. So Jesus comes on a day that he knows that this text from Isaiah is the text for the day. Jesus was not ignorant of the synagogue system. He was a rabbi. And so he gets there, and the attendant hands him the scroll of Isaiah, and he opens to the daily text, and it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me, meaning he has made me the Christ. He's made me the Messiah, to give sight to the blind and to bind up the brokenhearted and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And then he rolls up the scroll and he hands it back to the attendant and he takes the position of the one who's now going to teach about the passage that has just been read. So everybody's eyes are kind of fixed on him. What's he going to say about this messianic prophecy? What's he going to say about this expectation of God's anointed one who's going to come and deliver us? And what does Jesus say? Today, this is fulfilled in your hearing. And they're like, yeah, that is good news. They have been waiting. Their parents had been waiting. Their grandparents had been waiting. Their grandparents' grandparents had been waiting. They had been oppressed people first by Babylon and then by the Persians and then by the Greeks and then by the Egyptians and then by the Syrians. It had been a long time since they had had any sense of freedom. Now they're oppressed by the Romans. And if this guy is the guy we've been waiting for, this is good news. Not only is it good news that the Messiah is come, but the Messiah is our hometown boy. They start to say to one another, hey, this is Joseph's son, right? Like, this is really good news. We're going to put Nazareth on the map, right? Just imagine how good this is going to be for us. They all spoke well of him and wondered at his gracious words. That's what it says. They all spoke well of him, just like you all do of me. Everybody just thinks, man, Robbie, he's great. Just kidding. And so Jesus kind of says, in his kind of typical way, you know, prophets are never really accepted in their hometown. And they probably thought, what's he talking about? And he proceeds to tell a couple of stories. He tells a story about how the Hebrew prophet Elijah went up to a village north of them in Lebanon, near Zarephath in Sidon, it's the region, and he took care of a widow during a drought. A widow during a drought. Okay. And then he told a story about Elisha, the protege of Elijah, how during his public ministry, he had prayed for Naaman, and Naaman was healed of leprosy. Well, everyone who all spoke well of him now are ready to kill him. Like, that's a big difference. Like, none of you got in any way agitated or upset when I referenced those two stories about Elijah taking care of a widow in Zarephath or Naaman being healed of leprosy. You're thinking, I think I remember that story. But it didn't cause any consternation in you. I mean, it made these people angry enough that they wanted to kill him. You see, Jesus' message was not a message of conquering. It was a message of peace. And it was a message of peace not just for them, but for others. You have heard it said, don't murder, but I say don't hate. You have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say don't retaliate. You have heard it said, love your neighbor, but I say love your enemy. This kind of turn your cheek, go the second mile, give them your shirt when they sue you for your coat, judge not lest you be judged, kingdom, is not something anybody's prepared to hear. And they wanted to kill him for it. In fact, it doesn't come as a surprise to those who are insightful. Some 300 years before Jesus lived, there was a Greek philosopher by the name of Plato. His most famous book is called The Republic. And in it, Plato says, if there ever was a fully and truly righteous person, we would crucify him. Now, I don't think Plato's a prophet, but I think he's onto something. He knows how we're going to respond. And that response from they all spoke well of him to they wanted to kill him is a pattern that started early in Jesus' life, and it would stay with him throughout the rest of his life. Because it was just a week ago that we celebrated Palm Sunday. And Palm Sunday opens up with, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, right? Come and deliver us from the Romans. We're waving our palm branches, which is basically like a Jewish flag. Like, give us some national freedom, right? It's us versus them. But Jesus doesn't ride in on a war horse. He rides in on a donkey, on a donkey's colt, on like a baby donkey. And as he does so, he offers them something different. He offers them the same thing he was offering them way back at the beginning of his ministry when he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to bind up the brokenhearted, to give sight to the blind, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And it's going to look like this for everyone. And those same people who were all so excited about it, who wanted to kill him at the end, parallel all of those people who were shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, at the beginning of the week, and come Friday, they were shouting, crucify him, crucify him. Because that's what it's like. We don't want to be challenged, we want to be saved. We want to be forgiven, but we want everybody else's sins to be judged. But that's not how our God works. Our God has something else to offer us. And frankly, I think that we are actually telling the story in ways that are unfaithful. What's interesting about that Kid Logic podcast is that last story about the little girl who asked if they killed MLK too. Her logic actually isn't wrong. Not only is she thinking well, but she was actually connecting the right dots. That is exactly what we do to people like that. I mean, that story is different than the other story. The story where Ronnie Loberfeld is the tooth fairy, right? That comes to a wrong conclusion. Or the story that people get smaller when planes go up. That comes to a wrong conclusion. But the story that why King was killed and why Jesus was killed is very similar to one another, that's not a bad use of logic. It's a good one. And when we tell our story about why Jesus died, we often tell it in ways that sound something like this. This comes from Herbert McCabe. Interestingly, he's a Dominican theologian, and he died in 2001. He died the same year that podcast was first aired. This is not what he's advocating. He's saying this is how we sometimes say things. Why did Christ die? This tries to answer the question. So here's the answer. What had the death of Christ to do with us? Why is it so important to us? One such answer has been very influential in the past, is that his death paid the penalty for the sins of the world. The idea, I'm sure you will remember, was that sin had offended God, and since God is himself infinite, such an offense has a kind of infinity about it. It was within the power of the human creature to offend by disobedience to God, but it was not within our power to restore the balance of justice by any recompense we could pay to God. So God the Son became man so that by his suffering and death, he could pay the price of sin. This seems to be based on an idea of punishment as a kind of payment, a repayment. The criminal undergoing punishment pays his debt to society, as we say. It takes a divine man, however, to pay a debt to divine justice. But there's problems with that. The problem with that is it makes God basically sound just like us. Like God's just a good version of what we are. But God's not just a good version of what we are. God's infinitely better. McCabe goes on to say, well then, did the Father want Jesus to be crucified? And if so, why? The answer, he says, is again, no. The mission of Jesus from the Father is not the mission to be crucified. What the Father wished is that Jesus should be human. Any minimally intelligent people who are proposing to become parents know that their children will have lives of suffering and disappointment and perhaps tragedy, but this is not what they wish for them. What they want is that they should be alive, that they should be human. And this is what Jesus sees as a command laid on him by his Father in heaven. The obedience of Jesus to his Father is to be totally and completely human. In our series bumper, we kind of borrowed some clips from The Chosen. One of the things I like about The Chosen is that it portrays Jesus as a very kind of lovely person. He's full of joy, and he's full of happiness, and he's full of life. But sometimes we tell the story of the gospel that Jesus had a death wish, that somehow Jesus didn't want to live, but rather wanted to die. McCabe, I'm back to McCabe's sermon here. Jesus had no fear of being human because he saw his humanity simply as a gift from him whom he called the Father. You might say that as he lived and gradually explored into himself, asking not the question, who do men say that I am, but who do I say that I am, he found nothing but the Father's love. This is what gave all the meaning to his life, the love which is the ultimate basis and meaning of the universe. However he would have put it to himself, and this we know nothing of exactly, he saw himself as simply an expression of the love which is the Father and in which the Father delights. His whole life and death was a response in love and obedience to the gift of being human, an act of gratitude and appreciation of the gift, again, of being human. So the passage, the first passage from Acts that was read, when Luke wrote Acts, he hit this drum over and over and over and over. They killed Jesus. God raised him from the dead. And that's the gospel. Jesus didn't kill himself. He didn't die by suicide. And he was not crucified by the Father. We, like Plato predicted, came into contact with a righteous one, and we crucified him. We gave God our worst. And instead of retaliating, God responds with the resurrection. So that the cross isn't just some mechanism by which God plays some kind of cosmic trick on himself, so that he can go ahead and forgive us even though we don't deserve it and love us even though we're really unlovable. God knows exactly who we are, and he loves us. Our limitations aren't something to be lamented over. God made us with these limitations. You know what these limitations do to us? It requires us to be with other people and to rely on them and to live in relationship. Human limitations is one of the greatest gifts that we have because that's what requires us to be with God. Jesus did not in any straightforward way suffer the lightning bolt of the Father's wrath. His death was the fire of the Father's wrath, consuming death on the cross. Those are two very different ideas. One of them, I think, is a kid's logic that we have perpetuated in the church, that somehow Jesus was the object of the wrath of God, because we see the judgment of God on the cross. But the judgment of God on the cross is the judgment on sin and death. We know it's not just for a righteous person to die, right? If we found out that the state of Florida executed an innocent person, which very unfortunately we have found out on occasion, we say that's a tragedy. Yes? If an innocent person gets executed, we say that's a tragedy. If there ever was an innocent person, that innocent person is Jesus of Nazareth. And he was executed by the state. So on a human level, there is nothing just about the death of Jesus on a cross. That is completely unjust. So what we see there is not justice, but love. It is the love of Christ who is willing to remain ultimately and completely human. What did Jesus die of? One of the things Jesus died of was that he was human. And that when you crucify a human, they die, right? He died because he's human. And that was unjust. God responds to that with the resurrection. And in his response, we see his justice. Imagine that. The one who had been falsely accused and even put to death. In our world, that's beyond our repair. If we execute an innocent person, we just have to lament that fact. There's nothing we can do it to kind of, you know, reverse it. But luckily, again, God is not us. God takes the ultimate act of injustice and responds to it, the resurrection, which is God's justice. But there's another play here, and that is this. That Jesus and the Father are always working together. That doesn't say that Jesus in the prayer of Gethsemane kept praying, right? That's the promise that we too will all be resurrected and that we will get to live that life. And we believe as Christians that in our baptism, we in a way, reenact or even prefigure what that looks like. So we go down in the water representing our death, and we come up out of the water representing our resurrection, right? Dead both to sin and then cleansed to live new lives, but also, in a way, dead to death so that we can live a new life that will then become an everlasting life. And that's the gospel. That's the good news. That's what Sunday is all about. That's this plot twist that we're talking about. As C.S. Lewis said, he came to faith relatively late in life. And one of the reasons was he couldn't make sense of how it all worked. And he had read the gospel a number of times, and he eventually came to the conclusion that he thought it had to be true because no one could make this up. Like, the story's too good. But that is the story we have. And the plot twist is that the one who has come and has won and conquered, but not through death and destruction, but through sacrifice. And now we celebrate that every week when we come to the table and we talk about his broken body and his shed blood. No more bodies need to be broken. No more blood needs to be shed, because all of that has been done by our Lord on our behalf. And so what he invites us to do is just to receive that forgiveness and to embrace his joy and his peace and his life, which is remarkably wonderful news. Amen? Let's pray.
Let us pray. Incarnate God, we are grateful for the resurrected Christ. Thank you for the empty tomb. Thank you for followers running with good news. Thank you for your presence with us, alive and powerful. Today we celebrate your victory over death and over all the powers that would defeat us. We worship and praise your holy name. Risen Lord, help us to grasp the true meaning of the resurrection, to understand its power, to see its force at work in our world, overturning evil and bringing light to the darkness within us. May we recognize the movement of your Spirit directing us towards love and truth, and uniting us as beloved children of God. Holy God, on this day of great gladness, empower us to be your ambassadors, proclaiming the good news in our homes and our city, at our offices and schools, as we're working or resting. Help us to be that good news, befriending and caring for all people, partnering with you to bring your kingdom of heaven to earth. Brothers and sisters, whether you're joining us online or you're here in person, we invite you now to share a request and thanksgiving with the community and with the world. If you're joining us online, please just put in your request in the chat and they will make sure that we get that. If you're here in person, we have microphones set up on either side of the dais here. Just come and make your needs known or your requests.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to ask for prayers for Carrie, still. She has continued treatment for her lack of platelets, and it has not turned those around yet. So we're praying for, you know, her miracle, another one, which we know will come. We just need to be patient. But prayers for her peace, and it's starting to affect her mental health, and we just really want her to know God's got this, you know, and he's there and he's taking care of her this whole time. He will continue to do so.
Amen.
I'm updating you on Jasmine. I have prayer, praise, and thanks. Those of you that pray for her all the time, those prayers really saved her again. Last Sunday, her mom called me after church, and she was very, not really unresponsive, but she couldn't hold her head up, and she was just extremely out of it. We rushed her to Nemours Emergency. Her blood sugar was 33 from all the diarrhea that she had been going through and dehydration. But praise the Lord, he's not finished with her yet. The prayers, God's will, and the doctors, everything comes together, and she's full speed ahead again.
Amen.
wanted to pray for my friend. Her parents are going through a divorce, and there's a lot of problems with custody, and she doesn't know if she wants to move or stay.
Good morning. I have a co-worker named Al Landrum that passed away right before Easter, so I'm asking for prayers for his family. He was a good Christian, Baptist, and a gentle soul. Thank you.
I had an opportunity this week, excuse me, a little raspy in the throat. I run the food pantry, and from time to time, we always have opportunity to pray with people. But yesterday, while I was home and we were doing things at home, I got a strange phone call from a woman who was crying. She says, "You don't know me, and I don't know you, but I'm desperate. I need prayer, and I didn't know where to turn. I have brain cancer. They told me it's terminal, but I've been fighting breast cancer, other cancers in my body." She called a hotline. She says, "I'm desperate, I don't know what to do." And she says, "Well, I know this group. This guy might pray for you." Out of the clear blue sky, they just gave the phone number to the pantry, and I had answered it. And this woman told me her plot. And we prayed, and we prayed, and we prayed. And I continue to pray for her healing. And she says, after the prayer, she says, "I haven't been this calm in months for what God is doing." So I'm a believer. We talked, we shared. But I share this with you to say, you never know when God's calling you to be that person at that moment to pray with people. And I believe that we serve a mighty God in times of need.
Amen.
I was just going to share a couple things. I'm very grateful to get to go to the jail and talk to the girls, because they bring out something, make me see things I don't always see. And I got to talk, we've read in the Bible about Jesus dying, his resurrection, and just looking at the words, you know, he went to the Gethsemane, he prayed 3 times for this to pass. And I explained to the girls, he didn't want to go through this, but he said, "Not my will, but your will." And I think sometimes in our life, we have to really want to God's will more than our will, to do the right thing. And we also talked about, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And I was trying to talk to them about forgiveness. That does help to understand. Sometimes they do know what they're doing. They don't know the ramifications and what all it's going to cost. And then last, but this is kind of a if anybody can help kind of thing. I've been doing Guardian Ad Litem, and I have a mom who has found a place. She's going to move in April. Is working, trying to get her kids back. She just started her job a couple weeks ago, but she has to get her electricity turned on, and she owes a prior bill. And she just, you know, feels like she came this far, and she's about ready to lose it. So I'm just asking if anybody, next Sunday I'll be here, if anybody's got money that can help. I think her past bill is like $500. So if anybody can, I just really want to help her out, because she has worked so hard to accomplish everything to get her kids back. So those are my prayer requests for her. Just we could step in and help somebody. So anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
Pray for Gretchen. She's in her last semester, and she's just 1 month left. She has lots of travel, and she said lots of good things, but please continue to pray for her that she can end strong.
Amen. Let's pray. Didn't see you. You're sneaking out of the corner of my eye there.
I've got a friend who got married last week, and then the next day got into a really bad motorcycle accident. So he's broke his back and his legs, and so it's tough on the family. So just pray for him, his healing, and also for his wife and daughter.
Thank you. Now let us pray. Jesus, our Savior, in this broken and wounded world, we catch sight of your kingdom in the person of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns in us forever. May this be our focus today and every day. In the name of the Father, the risen Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Amen. In a moment, we're going to gather around the table. But if you're in the building and would like to pray with the pastor, you can come forward to the stage and do that. Otherwise, if you're online, we're going to share grace and peace. You can share grace and peace again in the chat section. But rise from your seat, if you will, and go greet somebody and give them the grace and peace of Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right, beloved. Servers, as you make your way back to your seats, servers are coming now and they're going to distribute for us the elements of communion. We ask that you hold on to those and we'll all partake together here in just a minute. I've already preached a long sermon, so I'm gonna try my best not to preach another one right now. But it has been a few weeks since I've been here. 2 weeks ago I was out of town, and then last week I was sick. And so it's all bottled up, I guess. But yeah, but maybe just to do one underscore. We laugh at that kid's logic, right? That Ronnie Loberfeld was the tooth fairy, or that planes get smaller. But we ought to laugh at versions of the gospel that make God sound like some kind of abusive father, and that somehow Jesus is protecting us from God. If there's ever someone we don't need to be protected from, it's God. Now, I'm a big, big, big fan of C.S. Lewis. I like his fiction and I like his nonfiction. I like his, in his fiction, I like his children's fiction, and I like his you know, fiction for adults. I think it's all great. But because it's analogous, it always fails in certain ways. And that I used to like about Aslan the lion, who's kind of the Christ figure in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Lucy, the little girl, will ask Mrs. Beaver, "Is he safe?" And she's like, "Oh no, he's not safe, but he is good." And I used to love that because that's what I thought Jesus was like. He wasn't safe, but he's good. And I've come to believe that that's just not true. That's like getting smaller on the plane, or Ronnie Loberfeld being the tooth fairy. It's using logic, but it's coming to the wrong conclusion. If there ever was a safe human, that safe human is Jesus. He's not going to do any harm to you. Like, when he's done with you, you're going to be better off than you were before. Even his judgment is going to be restorative. You know how the Proverbs will say that, you know, the wounds of a friend are better than the flattery of an enemy? You apply that logic now to Jesus. Of course he's good, but he is incredibly safe. And that's the story. That the one who could have come and killed is the one who came and died. And even though we were violent, God raised him from the dead. And in doing so, has set us free from sin and death. The Apostle Paul would say in his second letter to the Corinthians, if the rulers of this world had known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. And I think our understanding of the kingdom of God is so affected by our understanding of kingdoms of this world. When it says that Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, I don't think that means, hey, we can feel great about ourselves because our God is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, as though, you know, he even takes out the powerful. No. He's riding in on that donkey, and he's not lording it over anything or anyone. Because when he comes in on that donkey and we call him the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, it's because he's reaching out to you and he's going to treat you like a king and a queen and a lord. Because he's not going to treat you like a slave. He's going to treat you like a friend. He's going to treat you like a brother, like a sister. Which is why Paul will say we are joint heirs with Christ. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords because he's made us all kings and he's made us all lords. He is the quintessential egalitarian leader who says, I want to be with you and I want you to be with me and I want us all to be together. Well, what if I'm a zealot? come on in. What if I'm a tax collector? Well, why don't you sit next to the zealot? I think you two would need to talk to each other, right? Well, what if I'm a Democrat? Well, you're welcome here. What if I'm a Republican? You're also welcome. Well, what if I don't vote? Well, we have a seat for you right here. What if I'm an Alabama fan? Well, you can sit here. What if I'm an Auburn fan? Well, why don't you sit here next to Alabama fan? Now, what if I'm a Cowboy fan? Well, you're going to be cast out into outer darkness. That was for Phil Grimes. Yeah. This, my friends, is the table of the Lord. Not of the church, but of the Lord. It is made ready for those who love Him and those who want to love Him more. So whether you've never participated in communion or whether you've done this 1,000 times, it is God's wish that you would participate today because He wants to meet you here. So let us pray. God in heaven, we pray that you would send down your Spirit and sanctify these gifts of bread and wine. Make them the body and blood of Christ. And through them, Lord, sanctify us. Nourish our bodies, nourish our souls. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's confess together the mystery of the faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, He took some bread. He gave thanks, He blessed it, and He broke it, and He gave it to His disciples. And He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat the bread of heaven." Let's take and eat together. And as was their custom, after the meal, He took the cup of redemption, the cup of salvation, and He said, "This is my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink the cup of salvation." Let's take and drink together. Let us pray. Good Lord, we have received these, the gifts of God for the people of God. And Lord, we have come not out of our wealth, but out of our poverty, not out of our riches, but out of our weaknesses. Lord, we come loving you, but wanting to love you more. And so, Lord, fill us with your joy and your peace. Let us be agents of your mercy and your grace and forgiveness. Lord, may we be the plot twist in the lives of those that need to hear the good news of who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, since I have you all here on the same day, which is great, by the way, I love seeing you all, I wanted to make sure you had my phone number. So this is my number. It's the same number I've had for years, and I want you to have it. I know sometimes you think I'm not going to call the pastor or whatever, but you should, because, you know, pastors can get lonely, and you don't want me to be lonely. And I realize, too, that sometimes you might not call the pastor except in crisis. But if it's in crisis and you don't have my number, then you should get the number now, so when you do need it, you can have it. But even more so than that, I don't want you to wait until you have a crisis before you reach out, right? Because that way, as we go through your crisis together, whenever that does come, we'll have already built a closer relationship. And that's how I think it's supposed to work. So, since I had you all here, I wanted to make you sure you had that number. I'm not seeing a lot of phones out. So I'm thinking either you have that number, or I'm just going to have to put this up there again and make you take the number down. Let's confess together our giving confession. Say this with me. We believe that every good thing comes from God and that God's goodness is freely given. We devote ourselves to lives of generosity and resist the covetous ways of this world. We denounce the myth of scarcity and proclaim the abundance of your provision. Lord, teach our hearts to give joyfully and enrich us with that which does not corrupt or decay. Amen. All right, I'm just realizing now that we didn't sing the doxology earlier. What time is it? 11:26. We'll sing it next week. It's getting late. Mikhail's going to come, and he's going to let us know some various things. But again, welcome. It's a delight to have you all. Hope to see you next week.
Hey, good morning. Happy Easter. He is risen.
He's risen.
I'm surprised that hasn't been done like 20 times already this morning, but I'm glad to be with y'all. Want to also say welcome to y'all. Want to say welcome to all of our visitors. If you're here today, it's your first Sunday, or if you've recently started coming, we want to stay in touch with you. We want to know you better. And to help make that happen, in the backs of the seats in the auditorium, there's little cards. They're little communication cards. You can fill one of those out with some information and drop it in the offering box, and we would love to stay in touch with you. Plus, we have a little gift for you. A little something that you can take home with you to let you know that we're thinking about you and praying for you and glad that you joined us today. Today is the first Sunday in Easter, naturally, and we are starting our new Easter series called Plot Twist. It's going to be great. We're really looking forward to it. So this series continues next week, we're going to be kind of looking at all of the ways that Jesus kind of confounds our expectations and does what we don't expect him to do and kind of blesses us with a holy disappointment. So you're not going to want to miss that. That's going to be all through the Easter season. And we have a time now as we are going to move from the table to the lobby. We are going to have a time we call sobremesa. It's just a little opportunity for us to hang out together, spend some time with each other. There's some coffee left out there. If there's some donuts left out there, you can get a second round of donuts. Second breakfast, as we hobbits call it. We can spend some time in conversation and fellowship. So we also have that lovely photo booth that we set up out there. And so feel free to take your Easter pictures. Y'all look so nice. Best record it with some nice photos. And you can use the hashtag Easter at Oasis 2024. Hashtag Easter at Oasis 2024, because we would love to see those photos too. Cool? Cool. Go ahead and stand up. God in heaven, we are grateful that you are risen, Lord, and that you have shared your resurrection life with us. We pray that we would carry this with us as we go out into the world through our week, as we engage in our relationships and our work and our coming and our going. God, we pray that we would bear with us the love of God the Father, the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Go in peace.